Every day we read about events that strike us as absolutely horrible. Sometimes it's a terrorist attack, such as setting off a bomb in a subway station. Or it may be an active shooter situation in a school where innocent children are killed. We have heard stories of parents keeping their children chained in the basement and nearly starving them to death. There was a case not too long ago right in the Kansas City area where a man killed his stepson and then fed the body to pigs. In these situations, we have absolutely no doubt that a crime has been committed and that the criminal should be punished. These are lock them up and throw away the key type situations. From a spiritual perspective, we are also sure that such actions are sinful. To call them a sin hardly does them justice. We are certain that a person has sinned and that in his or her present condition will not go to heaven. They can be saved. If they truly repent, God will forgive them. But without conversion, they are outside of Christ, they are guilty of sin, and they will not be saved. And if our list of sins gets long enough, we eventually go past the really horrible and disgusting sins and get to things that are less serious than murder or child abuse. And at some point, we might say to ourselves, that is a sin. It's probable that the person will not go to heaven because of it. But then, who am I to judge? Or someone will respond to our opinion and ask, who are you to judge? This is especially likely if we simply say that seemingly good people won't go to heaven because they're not faithful Christians. Someone might even quote scripture and say, judge not that you be not judged. And so we are tempted to soften our judgmental statement. In everyday life, we all judge. It is inevitable. We make judgments between right and wrong. We make judgments so that we will do right and will avoid doing wrong. We see people do things and we judge that what they did was wrong, whether we say it out loud or not. We might even call it sin. When we decide that the murderer should be punished, we have judged his actions as being wrong. We might think that murder is worse than some doctrinal error on a passage of Scripture, but in both cases, we have judged. We have judged, we have decided that someone sinned or that someone violated Scripture in some way. Jesus didn't say to judge some things, not to judge other things. He said, judge not that you be not judged. What are we to do if we take the teachings of Jesus, all the teachings of Jesus, seriously? How are we to know which judging is forbidden and which is permitted? There are even some verses that require us to make some value judgment. Some of those verses are in the same chapter, in the same sermon of Jesus that says, judge not that you be not judged. How are we to figure out what we are supposed to do and how we should respond when we are challenged about our judgments? There are several things to consider if we are going to properly understand what Jesus meant when he said such things as, judge not. As we've often said, looking at the context, looking at the purpose of the statement is of extreme importance. Who was Jesus talking to? Why did he make this statement at this time to this group of people? What behavior was he trying to correct? What behavior was he wanting to encourage? For example, if two children are fussing and mom says, don't talk to each other, that has to be understood in context. It's not an absolute statement forbidding the kids from ever talking to each other again. We have to pay attention to the setting in which the statement was made. So here's what we're going to look at this evening. We're going to start with some background information about word definitions and some sample verses that use these words. Then we'll look more closely at three key passages on the subject of judging. And then we'll finish with some practical ideas about how to judge in a way that is obedient to God. We'll start with the meaning of the word judge when it's used in the New Testament. Now, there are some words, and we've been through some of these on various subjects before, there are some words in which we have only one word in English, but several different words in Greek that are all translated with that one word. An example that many of us have studied in classes before is the word love. In New Testament times, we know that in New Testament Greek or in classical Greek at the time, there were four or five different words for various expressions of attraction or affection. But in English, we translate all of those words with one word, love. Doesn't matter if it's passion or brotherly love or kindly affection or whatever. We use love for all of them, even though in Greek they had several words. Now, we might get confused because of that in English, but if we knew Greek, if we knew which word was used, we would more easily know what the writer meant in one case or the other. That's not the case with the word judge. For the idea of judging is the other way around. There is one predominant word in the New Testament that has several different but correct translations in English. So there's one Greek word, and we have several words that we use to translate it into English. Now, if you want to know what that word is, for what it's worth, the English transliteration is krino, K-R-I-N-O would be an English spelling of that. The most basic meaning of krino is simply to distinguish, to decide something. Common sense tells us that when Jesus says, don't judge, he did not mean that we should never distinguish between right and wrong, between good and evil. Nor did he mean that we shouldn't make decisions in life. But that's the word that would be used for those various meanings. Then there's a whole assortment of words that are used in different situations, in different passages, that are all based on the basic idea of distinguishing. And they include these that are on the screen right now. Avenge, conclude, condemn, decree, determine, esteem, judge, sue, ordain, and think. And it's our responsibility to look at the context when these words are used and judge which word best conveys the intended message. Now, here are some verses that illustrate how these words can be used. To make it a little bit easier, if you are trying to keep track in your Bible, all of these examples will come from the book of Acts, not because Acts is the only place that uses them, but I just thought it was easy to just work our way through the book of Acts. And the key thing is to remember that in all of these verses, at some point, they use various English words to translate the same Greek word for judge. Acts chapter 3, verse 13, Peter was preaching in Jerusalem and he said, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. Determined is our krino, our judge word. Now, the English Standard and the NIV have decided in that place, in place of determined. In Acts 4, verse 19, Peter and John were speaking before the Sanhedrin, and they said, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you judge. That was pretty obvious because they used the judge word. Peter and John were encouraging the Jewish leaders to decide what was right. It was imperative that they make this judgment. We should all make the same judgment that obeying God is better than obeying men when there is a conflict between the wishes of the two. Acts 13, verse 27, Paul was preaching to a Jewish audience in Antioch of Pisidia. This is up in Turkey area. And he was referring to the infidelities of ancient Israel. He said, "For those who dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not know him, nor even the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, have fulfilled them in condemning him." There's our word. The same chapter in verse 46 says that Paul and Barnabas grew bold and said, "It was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first. But since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we turn to the Gentiles." The last three examples all use English words other than judge for the same Greek word. Acts 16, verse 4, "As they went through the cities, they delivered to them the decrees." This is after the big meeting in Jerusalem deciding what to do about circumcision and that type of thing. "They delivered to them the decrees to keep, which were determined by the apostles and elders at Jerusalem." Both the NIV and ESV have "the decisions reached" in place of "determined." Acts 20, verse 16, Luke is simply describing a choice Paul made about travel plans, but he uses the judge word, for Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus. And finally, in Acts 26, verse 8, speaking to King Agrippa, Paul said, "Why should it be thought incredible by you that God raises the dead?" The NIV uses the word "considered incredible by you." In all of these verses, the original writer used the same word. Most of these call for or show some very appropriate, some very legitimate judging. And the very same word is used when Scripture tells us that God judges sinners. Now let's look at three passages that are key to understanding how Christians are to judge or not to judge. We'll start with the one that Miles read earlier in Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 4, which is the one that's often thrown at Christians when we confront sinful behavior. "Judge not, that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me remove the speck from your eye,' and look, a plank is in your own eye?" We have a similar passage in Luke chapter 6, verse 37, where Jesus expands on the idea a little bit. There he said, "Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven." These are not so much absolute commands as they are proverbial statements of general truths. It is a general truth that what goes around comes around. So if you judge or condemn, expect people to respond in kind. And a forgiving person is more likely to be forgiven by others. And if you're curious here, the word for condemn is not the same word as our word for judge. Matthew 7, verse 1 can be understood in much the same way as this verse in the parallel verse in Luke. If you're a judgmental person, don't expect people around you to cut you much slack when you mess up. Commentators also mention that this could be translated stop judging, rather than telling us not to do something that we've maybe never done before, theoretically, but it could mean stop judging, and that in that case the message would be, you are a judgmental people and you should stop judging for your own good. Jesus is especially concerned about a common practice of the Pharisees, who used a more severe standard for judging others than they did for judging themselves. And let's also note that the Pharisees had no monopoly on this use of a double standard. Then Jesus used the exaggerated illustration about someone with a plank in his eye trying to examine a tiny speck in his brother's eye. Now, if this were a literal situation, the fellow with a plank in his eye would probably be dead. It wouldn't be a sight problem, it'd be a life problem. You know, just figure that one out. But verse 5 then goes on to indicate that Jesus is more concerned with hypocrisy than with an absolute rule against dealing with sin and identifying it as such. He does not mean that we can correct someone else's sin only after we have eliminated all of our own sins. If that were true, then we could not obey the instructions that Jesus gives later in the very same chapter. In verse 15, he says, we are to beware of false prophets. How can we identify someone as a false prophet without some degree of judging? His message is that we are to be as concerned about our own sins as we are about the sins of others. Second passage to look at is in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 11 through 13. In the Corinthian church, there was this man who was living with his father's wife, presumably his own stepmother. His sin was known to the church, but they weren't doing anything about it. It's even possible that they were justifying their mind your own business approach by quoting the words of Jesus from Matthew 7. Who are we to judge a brother? We're not perfect either. Regardless of the obvious imperfections that we know much about because of 1 Corinthians, but regardless of the obvious imperfections of the Corinthian Christians, Paul didn't agree that they should let this sin go unjudged. But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral, or covetous, or an idolater, or a reviler, or a drunkard, or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person. For what have I to do with judging those also who are outside? Do you not judge those who are inside? But those who are outside, God judges. Therefore, put away from yourselves the evil person. Division or not in that congregation, this was a blatant sin that should not be tolerated. In fact, there was an entire list here of sins that, if present, had to be confronted. Fornication, greed, idolatry, slander, drunkenness, extortion. Go back up into verse 10 to get those. They were to break off fellowship with brethren who persisted in such behaviors. Judging was not just allowed, it was mandatory. Paul adds that they were not to judge the world. That certainly doesn't mean that they were to condemn the sins of non-Christians. If that were the case, why preach the gospel to them and call them to repentance? But they were not to take the same kind of corrective action with non-Christians that they took with members of the body of Christ. Third passage is in Galatians chapter 6, the first five verses. Brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one examine his own work, and then he will have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another, for each one shall bear his own load. All by itself, verse 1 requires several judgments. Someone was to intervene if a brother was overtaken in any trespass. That requires some level of judgment that the behavior is a sin that warrants corrective action. The action was to be taken by you who are spiritual. That too requires a degree of judging. Now we should be rightly very cautious about claiming to have that higher level of spirituality, but it still requires some judging to do what he says to do. Paul also makes here, without referring directly to it, he makes an application of that plank and speck principle. When approaching the brother who has fallen into sin, the spiritual one should be careful and gentle. Verse 3 adds the warning against thinking too highly of oneself. That's an excellent example of applying the balance called for in Matthew 7. But once again, it doesn't mean that because we are all sinners, we should never confront, correct, or help each other to overcome sin. Based on all of that, let's draw three guidelines for spiritual judging from these passages. Number one, whenever we judge, we must have a sincere desire to preserve ourselves from sin. That was Paul's concern for the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 5. If they didn't judge the fellow living with his stepmother, they would all be contaminated and influenced. The reputation of the church would be seriously damaged. If that sin was left unjudged, then other sins by other members would also have to be left unconfronted. Preserving ourselves from sin is included in the plank and speck illustration. And it's also involved in the word of caution there in Galatians 6. We are not to go looking for and at the sins of others with no regard to our own problems. Judging is to be done, but it is to be done by Christians who are as concerned about keeping their own lives pure as they are about helping others to overcome their sins. Number two, there must be a sincere desire to call the sinner to repentance. We can rephrase that by saying that there must be a sincere desire to save the sinner from condemnation. When the Pharisees brought the adulterous woman to Jesus in John chapter 8, they were not concerned with getting that woman to repent. Their whole purpose was to condemn her. That's what they were trying to do. They wanted to condemn her, and if possible, they wanted to get Jesus to sin against the law of Moses in the process. If judging is our purpose, then we had best not judge. That purpose is in itself a plank in the eye. If judging is our method, but our purpose is repentance and conversion and salvation, then we are doing what we are supposed to do. Paul had a similar attitude towards the group of non-Christians identified as Jews. In Romans chapter 10, the first three verses, he was writing about his concern for his Jewish kinsmen. They were not saved because they had never accepted Jesus as the Christ. Someone might have said, though, to Paul, how dare you judge these devout, Bible-believing, God-fearing Jews? But Paul didn't refrain from judging them as being lost. But he was passionately committed to bringing them to belief and repentance and salvation. There we go. Number three. We must keep in mind the obvious fact that we are all sinners who are dependent on God's grace. We don't judge and correct others because we are without sin. And that may have played a role in the statement of Jesus in Matthew 7. The Pharisees felt that they were sinless and that therefore they had a right to judge others. But they did not see it as their responsibility to help others overcome sin. So in Matthew 23, Jesus described them this way: "For they bind heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers." They were willing to judge, but they wouldn't lift a finger to help a sinner do better. We don't judge because we are sinless, but precisely because we are sinners and we know that sin can be hard to overcome. It's not a matter of being qualified to judge. It's more a matter of wanting to help someone defeat sin. Satan doesn't want us to judge and correct each other. He would much rather that we sin and let sin. He will encourage the sinner to resist judgment and correction. He'll make us afraid that someone might say, "Who are you to judge?" He might even quote Scripture, "Judge not, that you be not judged." When Satan gets his way, sin that could have been overcome will go unchecked. Souls will be lost that could have been saved. Judging and correcting must always be done with gentleness and humility, as we saw in Galatians 6. Judging must be motivated by a genuine desire to defeat sin and to save sinners. Jesus died to save sinners. That in itself was a judgment. But he came and died to save us from final judgment. And those who believe in him, who repent of their sins and are baptized, will be saved. And he puts us in the church so that we can help each other live as saved people should, so that we can even at times correct each other. If you need the prayers of the church to help you overcome sin, just ask. If you need to respond for baptism, for prayers, come forward. Let's stand, let's sing.